And we should be live.
Hi, everybody. Suzy and Arlene from Fiberygoodness.com. And tonight we're giving you something a little bit different than we've done in the past. Instead of a broadcast about happy, fuzzy yarn things and spiffy new equipment and shiny courses, we're actually welcoming you to our first fiber artist business chat. Question and answer session. And this came out of the newsletter article that we included in our newsletter that went out, I guess, about 2 weeks ago now, which, by the way, if you aren't on the newsletter, you can sign up, of course, through the website. And if you want to get a copy of that particular newsletter, just email us at info@fiberygoodness.com.
Oh, Mama made it easier than that. I've actually put a link to it on the website. So if you go to the sign-up
page. Oh, great. Thank you. Surprise to me.
You can pick it up right there. So all our most recent newsletter will be posted on that page.
Okay. Awesome. Even better. In the newsletter article, I presented one strategy for business and one tactic. And before we actually get into what that is all about, I didn't dress up for you tonight in my normal office gear because I've been actually at a yoga retreat all weekend and I'm still in that gear. But I did dig out a picture of you, of me in my office gear. There I am.
I'm going to share it.
Hang on. Looking office-y.
Oh, hang on. Oh, I lost it again. Hang on a sec. You know, I've only had like one coffee so far. screen sharing might be a little problematic today. Here we go. Here we are.
There I am in all my office glory.
All your office glory.
So for those of you who don't know, Monday through Friday, and then sometimes not only one Monday through Friday, but beyond, I'm the chief operating officer for a large public accounting firm in the United States on the East Coast. So that's what I do. And that's what it looked like when I knew it.
And you're really good at it. You haven't said, but you've won awards and innovation recognitions. And Arlene knows what she's doing.
Oh, I've had practice. Lots and lots of practice. All right, you can take that picture down. Thank you. Okay, so tonight we're going to talk about one strategy and one tactic. And I think both of them are ideas that you can take something away from, whether you're starting your business or whether you've had a business for a while. And first of all, let's just back up and talk a little bit about the difference between what's the difference between a strategy and a tactic? Because it can be confusing. So strategy is like a pretty high level view of something. So for example, a strategy in your business could be, I'm going to promote my business and increase my customer base through the use of social media. You know, it's very general, doesn't have any specifics, but it's something that you're going to do. Now, the tactical part of that would be very specific. Something like, oh, hey, look, I've got 1,200 followers on Pinterest, and I really seem like I have a lot of traction there, and I'm getting a lot of traffic over to my website or over to my Etsy shop through Pinterest. So I'm going to really make sure that I'm on Pinterest and I'm pinning frequently and I'm getting more traffic there and I'm building on that. So that would be how you would tie together the two. So high level and then real specific. So, but as creative people, a lot of times we don't take the time to think in these terms. Most of us are little tiny micro businesses, one person, in our case, two people. Maybe you even own a shop where you employ a person or two. And we just don't take the time to really think at a high level about what we're doing. As Suzy, you know, pointed out, we can be quite reactive.
But that's what I often end up doing, and it's a problem for me. Is that I get busy and then I start like just putting out fires rather than going out and making them. So I end up just reacting to demands rather than actually starting, you know, refocusing every day on what I need to actually achieve for my business.
And I will tell you that the good thing about there being two of us, and the lucky thing is that I think it does help us to be a little more proactive, because one of us can be in a completely reactive mode and the other one can say, oh, you know, let's take a step back. Let's, you know, zoom up out of the weeds and let's look at this from a higher level.
I have to say that it's usually Arlene that does that. Lucky me.
It's not important who, it's just important to get stuff. So in our newsletter, we shared specific thoughts around the strategy of leverage, and I'm going to go over that again. And then we shared about the tactic of making sure that the financial side of your house is in order, of your business house is in order. So to review, the concept of leverage means principally leveraging your own time appropriately. And a lot of times what that ends up meaning is peeling off tasks and pushing down work to someone else.
And I have to say here too that as a creative person, when you are being artistic and you're in creative mode, it's very, very difficult to go into business mode. So it often seems like the easiest part of our jobs is spinning the yarn and making things. The hard part is selling them and getting people to look at them and expanding as a business so you can actually keep funding making more. So that is actually one of the more difficult things for us as craftspeople, is to focus on the business side of what we're actually doing. And it's often an awkward thing for us to do as well, because a lot of people see this as a hobby and they look at you as though, yeah, but isn't this a hobby? But actually, no, it's a business and it's something I want to develop into something I have a vision for. So this is kind of like the hard yards of doing what you got to do, but it's so important.
But the realization is usually around, if I'm the rainmaker for the company or the business, if I'm the person that has to do the selling, whether it's at festivals, whether it's creating online content, then I really need to maximize that's my principal best use. So that involves a lot of times figuring out how to let go. And someone else, of course, will never do anything the way that you do it, but you can't do everything. And this is where one of the things, you know, sort of open raincoat right now, that over time, Suzy has had a little harder time than I have in terms of letting go of some responsibilities, so that obviously Suzy's extremely creative and she makes beautiful content. And that's really key, that we try to maximize her time in that respect. So there have been times when I have, you know, come on. But we have been successful in doing that, but it has been a process.
Yeah, it's because I am a bit of a control freak, and I think a lot of people are like this. When they're creating something, it becomes your, you know, your baby, and you have a certain vision for how you want things to be and how things should work. And I have had difficulty letting go of particular tasks and activities just because I kind of feel like, well, I want it done a certain way, and I'm not comfortable with giving it to somebody else and feeling that they're going to make it how I want it because I'm fussy and a control freak. But Arlene is absolutely spot on with this, because, you know, if it comes down to it, where is your time better spent? It's actually better spent being creative, because that's your biggest strength. So finding the right people to help you let go of tasks is really important. And for me, that has meant finding people that I have a lot of confidence in. And I don't have any hesitation to pass on tasks now to Evanita and to Jan, because I know that they can pick things up and they're running in the same direction that Arlene and I are running, and we're all in it together. So I have found that that's helped me a lot to let go of some of the tasks that I was probably hanging on to for too long. And it's freed me up to do a lot more other things.
There are often times that you'll look at something and you'll say, well, I wouldn't have done it that way, but it's perfectly fine.
Yeah. And that's also the thing, is reminding yourself that maybe I wouldn't have done it that way, but it's actually really good. And remembering that, you know, other people will bring other skills and talents and come up with ideas that you hadn't thought of. So, you know, it's that together we are mighty thing.
Right.
And allowing people in to do that is probably the hump to get over.
So one of the humps around that is somebody might say, well, I can't afford it. I can't afford to pay someone. So there are some inexpensive options, obviously, if you're in a position where trade or barter makes sense. Interns is also an option. If you're looking for someone maybe in the personal assistant category to help you get things done, you can get fractional employees, virtual assistants, that kind of thing. So, you know, the reality is that if you can identify what you need and you think about it and you just open your mind up a little bit and you start looking around, and it'll, you know, a solution will appear if you're open. So there's definitely encourage people. That's a big one right there, is it doesn't mean that you have to put somebody on payroll and pay a lot of money. It does mean that you have to be open and look around and look for opportunities and think about it in creative ways. And an example that I wanted to bring up was like from years ago when I first started Spin Artiste. You know, in the beginning, I did everything. I created the website by myself. I had no experience doing that. I had to figure out WordPress all on my own because I wasn't going to sink a lot of money into it. And then I definitely hit a wall where there were certain things I just could not do. And so I went to the WordPress developers forum. I created a little login, you know, to sign on. I created a little tiny ad for free. And I found someone who was efficient and reasonably priced. And, you know, that person blew through my problem in like an hour that I would have spent 10 hours on. And it was totally worth it for me. And then later on.
And I think you can identify too when you hit that wall, because you can spend hours and hours and hours, and it feels like, you know, you're just running up a hill all the time, because everything you're doing, especially with website building, that it's all such a big learning curve. And so it's like every time you start something new, you have to actually learn it right from scratch. So when you hit that wall, you could literally spend weeks and weeks and weeks trying to learn how to do something where somebody else could do it in half an hour.
Exactly. And it's just logic, to give people a lot of information around that hitting the wall realization, because, you know, some things you just can't solve no matter how much you try. That's actually easy to see, right? But then there's some things that you think, if I just spent more time on it, I kind of can get through it. You know, it's kind of more of a gray zone. Like, I could do it. I shouldn't spend the money on it. But this is a big trap. And it's also sort of related to another very closely related concept around this, is you start finding yourself procrastinating. When you start to find yourself procrastinating about something, that is a big, big sign. And it's, you know, we tend to think, oh, procrastination is horrible and I'm rotten and I shouldn't procrastinate. But actually, you can use that procrastination as a pointer towards something to look at.
So now, turn into something positive that way.
Right. So that's like, ding, 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 I'm procrastinating. So why am I procrastinating? Is it because I don't know how? Is it because I really hate doing that? Or is it because I'm afraid of doing that? So, you know, this is like a real sign to yourself, is you want to drill down on anything that you find yourself procrastinating. So now with the procrastination, if you are procrastinating around things that involve the marketing and selling of your business, you really need to take a look at that. That's not the same as procrastinating on balancing your checkbook. And I know, Suzy, you have a lot of thoughts on that, and you've actually written some interesting content about that.
Well, quite some time ago, when I started selling on Etsy with my Woolwich brand, I put a lot of thought into this. And when I was thinking about branding and how I could make, because Etsy, as most people know, is filled with beautiful hand-spun yarns, and many of them photograph beautifully, and I was looking and thinking, how do I make what I'm doing stand apart from everybody else's so that I'm recognizable? And what I realized was, what I was actually doing was not marketing my yarn. It was not marketing my fiber. It was actually marketing me. because that's what makes my stuff unique from anybody else's, because it's my stuff. And so what is it then that's unique about me? And that can be a big barrier to, or it can actually be a big plus for your procrastination aspect, because what you're doing is you're actually putting yourself out there, and potentially people can criticize you, they can tell you you're not good enough, and it's hard not to take it personally, because what you're doing is marketing a part of yourself, and it can really lead to a lot of procrastination. And I think somewhere along the line you've got to kind of start separating it out a little bit, and like Arlene said, putting things into places where you can work on them, instead of just having this generalized anxiety feeling about how to market my business and what can I market, and taking it as a personal thing. So your branding is all kind of matched up with how you market and how you promote your business, and that can cause you some barriers, I think, because it is such a personal thing, and it's
it can, because this is actually an artist. Something you really cannot hand off.
No,
if you hesitate about promoting yourself online, no one else can actually do that effectively for you, because online promotion is so much is about the buyer clicking with your persona. So nobody else can be you. So if this is on your big procrastination list, you're going to have to either be satisfied with where you are now, or you're going to have to start pushing yourself emotionally to make that jump.
Yeah. And I think identifying your strengths is part of that. You know, if you actually sit down and make yourself a list of all the things that you're really good at, the things that make your stuff unique or different or give you your own style, if you can start identifying those, it also helps you get over that little hump and make you feel a lot better about putting yourself out there and actually marketing your work, rather than just going out and saying, oh, I think this is okay, maybe someone will buy it. Put it out there and say, I've done something that I'm really proud of, and it's part of my brand and it's part of who I am, and it does help to get over the procrastination. But I mean, it keeps coming back, doesn't it? I mean, we all have moments where we have self doubts and, you know, wallow in our cups of coffee in the morning thinking, what am I doing?
So now let's talk about how to overcome that. So I'm going to give you guys homework if you want. It's up to you if you'd like to participate, but it's a little free business coaching. And that is take the all the items that you've been procrastinating on. Actually, let me back up and say it doesn't have to be all of them. It can just be a half a dozen. So if you take that list and take the item that you've actually been procrastinating over the longest and break that down into little pieces, what does that really involve? So for example, when I was hiring the WordPress developer person, I had to figure out how to get onto that developers forum. I had to figure out where to go. I had to figure out what to say, you know, to look at other ads, how much to pay, you know, kind of like do a little analysis around that, just informal. And, you know, how to create my little job description or my little ad and then do it. So break it down into these little tiny pieces and make whatever's at the top of that list the first little step, the highest priority. In the mix of all other things you're trying to get done, put that right up at the top too. And then do it. And then do the next one and do the next one. So you're going to find out that pretty soon you're going to be walking across the floor, put one foot across in front of the other.
So it's kind of like facing your fear, writing it down, but then taking it in small bites. To make it manageable.
Right. And not eat an elephant in one bite. That's it, how it goes. So I'm going to make an offer to any of you that feel really passionate and serious about making this change in yourself. And that is, if you will make your procrastination list and you identify your largest, oldest, scariest item that you know you need to move on, you break it down into your steps, and you figure out a deadline for yourself for the first step. If you want to email me what it is and when it needs to be done, I will follow up with you. So if you say, WordPress developer, I need to go online and figure out how to log into the WordPress developer site, and I need to do that in the next 2 weeks, and you email that to me, in 2 weeks, I'm going to send you an email, and I'm going to ask you if you did it.
So there's nothing like accountability.
No, there's nothing like accountability. And let's talk about what does accountability mean? That means I did what I said I was going to do when I said I was going to do it to the best of my ability. Okay, so that's what we're looking for there.
Yeah. And it also just helps you feel more organized. You know, can it sometimes feel as though you're sort of wallowing in a little bit of a chaotic, you know how your fiber stash gets sometimes, and you know that you need to clear it up, but it just kind of gets put off and put off and put off. It can be a little bit like that when you're trying to run a business and that you have all these little chaotic things going on around you. So even just doing this one step can help you actually feel like you are in control of the process and start being proactive about it. So it's a good offer of Arlene's.
I definitely take that one. So if you want to take me up on that, you can just send it to info@fiberygoodness.com. And in the subject line, just say, for Arlene, okay? And then Suzy and Evanita won't need to look at it. Just send it to me.
See, that's where I can let things go. Oh, Arlene's going to deal with that one.
Right.
So I'll just let it go.
So that's the strategy side. And before we move on to the tactical part of the conversation, Suzy, can you just check in and see if there's any questions about what we were just talking about?
Well, Artis is wondering if this needs to be fiber business related or in any area of our life.
Any area.
Yep. I think as soon as you start to feel organized in any area, it spreads. It's got a little snowball effect. You organize one thing in your life and the things around it start to feel more under control as well. Jennifer also says she procrastinates a lot on trying to find her brand, and I think this is something that it also develops over time. It takes some time to get to that and to find your own direction. What is it that you want to achieve? Is it you want to make yarn and sell it so you can make more yarn? Or do you want to change the world with eco yarns? Or do you want to become an innovator? Or do you want to share things because you love to share things? I mean, this is all part of shaping up your direction and where you want to go with it as well. And it could be that you may find the things you procrastinate on are the practical steps to get you there. So, and that's why it's important to take them even as baby steps, because you might have the big dream, but you've still got to have the pathway to get there. And that can hold you up as well and make you procrastinate, because you know where you want to go, but the steps to get there seem too big. So that, making a plan. And I have to say, I have the advantage of Arlene's spreadsheets and task lists and things. It's so much better to be organized.
Okay, are we good to move on?
If anyone has any questions, just I'm watching the chat, so I will relay them. So okay. Help yourself. Make whatever questions you like, and we'll see what we can do.
So now brace yourselves. We're moving into the tactical portion of our conversation. And in the newsletter, the tactical example was around financial management, which is a subject that a lot of people are scared of, do not like.
I'm going to use the word scared there too, actually, isn't it?
I don't understand. And I would say I'm probably somewhat evangelical on this point. If you read the newsletter, you know that I pretty quickly, after we got going, and probably other from the outside looking in, it seemed super early. We got set up with, professional bookkeeper. And of course, one of the principal reasons was I always felt that Suzy, as my partner, deserved to know at any time what was going on. If I'm receiving the money and I'm making distributions to her, I wanted to be able to show her at any time, this is where we are, this is what's happening.
This is where we were lucky that we could divide up our strengths as well, because that side of the business, I mean, it was just a no-brainer that it goes to Arlene, because this is really one of her strengths on organizing this kind of stuff. So if you're lucky enough to have someone to work with where your strengths complement each other, you really need to, you know, keep that in the front and make use of it, because it's just, it's logical again.
And part of my sales pitch around this is, not only is it just a good thing to have for yourself, but by having your money organized, you can do things that actually are very good for your business in other ways. And one of the key policies that we have put in place is we pay our suppliers immediately. Okay. So if someone orders a product from us and someone else is part of that supply chain, like say equipment supply in particular, and we've received the money, we place the order. As soon as we're invoiced for that product, we pay for that product. Now, it's not only that I just like want to get them the money because I want to get out of the account because it's easier for me to see what I can distribute. But more importantly, your suppliers love you for this more than anything else. You could be the nicest person in the world. You can have all the sales in the world. But if you don't pay people on a timely basis, nothing is more stressful in a business relationship than that. So if you want to have the greatest reputation with the people that you work with, pay them promptly. Pay them as soon as you can. Pay them. Get that money out of your hands. Pay them when they want the money. Even if they say their terms are 30 days, pay them before that. Make a great impression here, because this is going to build you the best relationships.
And relationship building is such a key, isn't it, within this business? It's a small niche, really, and people know each other, and having good relationships is really a good basis, I think. There's a question from Melissa, and she's asking, do you mean you should put money aside for the business?
Yes. Yes, I always set that money aside. I always know how much it is. I keep track of it. You know, there's different ways of doing that. There's different ways of doing everything that we're talking about. And I can only say this is what's worked for us. And I also know that in all the years that I've been in my professional capacity, the customers that we always love and will fall all over to do anything for are the ones that pay us right on time. Any customer that I have to pick up the phone and harass for money when they need something from me, and in my world, that could be they drop off their tax information at the last minute and they want to be filed on time, but they haven't paid us for a year. You've got no latitude there. So, you know, it's like really important to be a good corporate citizen. And yes, we always do set that money aside. And even beyond that, another aspect is we never drain all the money out of the company either.
Okay. Well, Deborah is asking, how do you calculate in the beginning? I guess, how do you calculate how much you're going to need to put aside? And are there variables to account for in that? What do you do when you're planning?
Yes. So there's the stuff that we absolutely know is going to happen, right? So somebody bought a wheel. And we know about how much that's going to, you know, even with the conversion rate, we know pretty much what we have to have in our hands. I just automatically set that aside. Even though I'm not going to get billed right away, I automatically set that aside. Do I have a spreadsheet for that? Yes, I have a spreadsheet for that.
Of course you have a spreadsheet.
If anybody wants to see an example of it, I'm happy to share it. It's not real magical. But, you know, and this is another little trick that everything that we do is in Google Docs, and that way Suzy and I can both see it at any time, and Evanita for the things that pertain to Evanita. And that's like another like real key to making this all work, because let's say I have the flu and I'm down for the count for 3 or 4 days, and somebody wants to know a status of an order, you know, she can go look at that, but that's a side thing. Yes. So when it comes to
a list of what our expenses are, like web hosting, we know that's a set amount. Our Vimeo channel, that's a set amount.
Right.
We can calculate that out over the following year and what our actual cost will be.
Yeah.
And we can plan
tracking. Yeah. When you're tracking this on a regular basis, and because we do have a bookkeeper, we can see what it is. We know what our monthly burn rate is. We know how much those regular expenses are. So we know we can never spend down past that amount. But also beyond that, we also leave some money in the company for emergencies. You know, if like on the courses, there's certain courses that people can get refunds for or partial refunds for, and you never know when that's going to happen. And sometimes somebody has a specific situation where, even though it's maybe not your policy, you're going to go out of your way and do something nice for them. And, you know, so we need to have money for that. So because we have our financial house in order, at any given time, you know, I can drill down pretty easily to what it is, where we are. And I give Suzy these little reports and I'll say, right now, you know, all the bills are paid because we always pay them right away. So there's never an issue with that. We know we have bills coming in of X. We have this much money right now. That means you would have so much left over. And, you know, we spend down to a certain amount and then we leave the rest in there. It's like for a rainy day, right? Just like you
and
would
it's all part of for tires. Relationship building and building up trust, because if someone needs a refund for something, if they've had an emergency and they have to pull out of a course for some reason, we can give them a refund straight away and they know they can trust us to do that. And it's the same with building that relationship with suppliers. We want them to trust us that when we need to pay them, we will pay them. And it's all part of that relationship building. And unfortunately, the financial side of things is actually a really vital part of that. There's a few people asking about the spreadsheets, and I would definitely recommend learning as much as you can about how to use a basic spreadsheet for cash flow purposes. I think there's probably quite a few tutorials online, like even with Microsoft on their website, there's probably tutorials, but I'll see if I can find something. It's not my strength, spreadsheets either, so I understand.
Well,
Melissa's even asked if she can have a template. It's probably something available already.
I would be, again, because I'm really passionate and evangelical about this, and I have a firm belief that no one really ever cares about your money as much as you do. So I know a lot of times people just kind of abdicate that to someone else to handle, and they don't ever really take an interest in what does the information say. So if you are in any kind of bookkeeping, QuickBooks or Quicken or anything like that, if you have any kind of a system, I would be happy to do a little seminar on how to read your financial statements. I can make it really simple, not scary. I'm really passionate that people should understand that. It's not that difficult. And it gives you really a lot of freedom to have that understanding. But let's say you're not there. Let's say you're just using PayPal, for example. So there are PayPal reports that you can use. They're not as easy to see, but we can do a whole thing about PayPal reports too. And PayPal, they have some regular monthly reports that are canned, but also you can request reports that are not canned. And I do this all the time. And you can download the information into a spreadsheet format. And then I do use this a lot. For example, with Natalie and Suzy and the Die Secrets courses. So I'm accountable to two other people there, right? Because we have a sharing model around that. So there's a lot of times when I don't want to wait to get them their distributions. So I'll go into PayPal and I'll download a report. Say, you know, we opened a course up and the course has been open up for 2 weeks and I want to make sure that I get some money out to them. I'll go ahead and I'll download the activity for the 2 weeks and I'll figure out what I owe them and I'll pay them right from there. And I don't even wait for my monthly financials to do that. Again, you know, my partners really love that. I'm like, oh no, you got to wait a month. No, I'm like, here's your money. So I take the time to do that. And we can do a separate webinar on how to use PayPal effectively.
There's a few questions on this too, actually. Deborah has suggested that lynda.com is a good resource for learning to use programs like Excel.
Mm-hmm.
Resource. Myra has asked, and also Jennifer, about percentages. Myra wants to know if we pay ourselves a percentage of profitability or a set amount weekly or monthly. And Jennifer's also asking if we'd recommend at the beginning putting 100% of our profit back into the business rather than paying ourselves out.
Okay, so the first question about how much equity to leave in the company. You need to get a handle on what your monthly expenses are, even if it's just a rough projection. You know, what are you going to have the business pick up? Well, one thing you're probably going to have the business pick up is your internet connection, right? And you know what that bill is. Maybe your cell phone. You know, so you have like these little routine bills. So you know you've always got to have that there. And then you've got other bigger things that you can kind of see on the horizon, like you're going to a show and maybe you need to order some supplies, some bags or something like that. So you kind of have to decide, you kind of have to look at your sales and you kind of have to develop a feel for what your bread and butter is. I'll give an example because I don't know if Melissa Yoder Ricks is watching or not.
Yes, she's here.
Okay. Hi, Melissa. So I always, believe it or not, I think about Melissa when I think about this. So Melissa makes...
She's so good at the shows and her stock.
Stunning sock yarn.
Such an amazing stand at the shows. I mean, you've got to do a lot of planning.
She has a beautiful stand. And one of the things that she's been making for years, and she makes beautifully, is this gorgeous hand-dyed sock yarn. And she makes a lot of it. And that's one of her sort of bread and butter products. She's always making it. She's been selling it for a long time. And that would be the kind of product that, and we have products like this too, but I'm using a different person's example here, obviously, that you look at and you say, you know, that product I'll use another example, one of our e-spinning books. You know, we know we sell X of those every month. So we're going to make, that's like a bread and butter product for us. It's just a little product and it throws off a little bit of income. So, and like with Melissa's sock yarn, she probably has a kind of an idea about how much that sock yarn is going to bring in because she's been doing it over time. So you look at that and you say, well, I'm going to pick numbers. Let's say from your bread and butter products, $500 a month comes in. So you can kind of, you know, reliably, okay, forgetting doing shows, forgetting teaching a class, forgetting those like large spikes in income. My bread and butter product sells, I sell about $500 a month. So my expenses shouldn't be more than that to the best I can control on a your routine expenses. The stuff that's over and above that, that's where, you know, you have to look again and see, you have to estimate like what extraordinary expenses you're going to have and when you're going to need them. So all this requires a little like writing down, following what you do, writing down and estimating and coming up with what you think your cash burn rate is and what your bread and butter products are going to throw off. Then after that, you look and you see what's left over for me to take out. And should I take it out? You pick a threshold, like I like a certain amount.
Should I take it out when I
should I take it out?
Should I leave it in?
Or should I leave it in? It's gut feel. At a certain level, it's kind of gut feel.
I think there's also going to be some months where you can take out 100% and other months where you know you're going to have to put some aside because you've got a show coming up and you're going to have to pay for the materials and so on.
Right.
So it's probably going to be varied. It's not going to be like an all the time I'm going to take out 80% and even 20. Sometimes you might need to even more.
So correct. You said it way better than me.
There might not be a simple answer to that one, but I think the forward planning is really important to that and knowing exactly what you've got coming up, keeping in mind that you want to be able to pay your suppliers. So that's probably going to change from quarter to quarter how much you're taking out of it. Melissa Yoder Ricks also had a good question about what would you expect a fiber business to pay each month for bookkeeping services? And I think that's a really good question.
It is a good question. I will tell you that on average, it takes our bookkeeper about 1 to 2 hours. Sometimes most of our income comes in through PayPal, 95%. So that's good because she only has to deal with that. And it takes her an hour or two. Sometimes PayPal doesn't behave particularly nicely and it takes her a little longer. So from there, you know, I would say depending upon where you live, a bookkeeper could be anywhere from $40 an hour to $75 an hour. And you can work with your bookkeeper to to say, looking at what I have here, how much time do you think this would take every month? And, you know, kind of, and what tasks would be involved? Because if you can only afford $50 a month, but maybe there are certain tasks, let's say she says it's $100, but you can only afford 50. You know, talk about the tasks. Maybe there are still some tasks that you have to retain right now until you can grow into that full expense. And so kind of work it out with the idea that you're moving towards being able to afford it if you can't now.
So it's something you could actually work out with your bookkeeper.
Right. You know, you can say, be honest with her, like, okay, I have $50 to spend. What are the full set of tasks? And then go back and forth and say, okay, I'll still do this part for now. And know that you're trying to get to the place where you could afford to pay for the whole thing.
That makes sense.
Did we get everybody's question? I think so.
If I missed anyone's question, just post it again and I'll see it come up.
Okay.
Let's do the time.
Let's see here. Information. Okay. Back to the leverage concept. The resource that I listed in the newsletter was a book called The E-Myth Revisited by Michael Gerber. If anybody is a reader and they want to dive a little more deeply into the concept of leverage and how and when, that book, I think, describes it the best, that particular subject.
Robin's just asked, what are the tasks for the bookkeeper?
The bookkeeper, she downloads the reports. She reconciles the reports. She reconciles, if you had a separate bank account, she would reconcile that too. She prepares the financial statements for us.
That's really useful for your tax purposes at the end of the year.
Yes.
To have all that really
yes,
useful.
It's already done. There's no waiting around for somebody to, you know, mire through 12 months worth of entries. And there is a little bit of communication involved. I do have to look and give her some heads up around certain things. Like, for example, there's a monthly reimbursement for an internet charge for Suzy. So when I pay that out to Suzy, that's not a disbursement of profit. That's just a reimbursement. So I do have to clarify to the bookkeeper that, but after you do it one time, she knows, and that's automatic.
That's all the questions we got at the moment.
Okay. I hope we did a good job at answering them. I felt like I sort of rattled on and went off on a tangent there for a bit. But feel free, obviously, to follow up with any other questions. I know people are going to watch this in the recorded version. We had a lot of questions about whether this is going to be available. It is going to be available. So if you need to go back and rewatch it, or if you think of something else that you want to ask, just shoot us an email at info@fiberygoodness.com. Subject biz question or for Arlene, or biz question for Suzy and Arlene, or whatever, and we'll be happy to answer it with you, because, you know, part of community is a big thing for us, and I have a passion for business and I have a passion for people succeeding in business. So if you want to get me on your team, just send me an email and I'll try to help you move past some of your blocks.
Also, if we get a lot of emails in and there's a particular theme that's coming up regularly, then there's no reason why we won't do another session.
Right.
Another session as
absolutely.
Well.
Absolutely.
It's good to actually send questions in so that we know what people are most interested in, then we can focus on that for the next one. Deborah's asking who the author was again of that leverage book.
It's Michael Gerber, G-E-R-B-E-R. It's not a real long book. It's kind of a good read, actually. E-Myth Revisited.
That's good to know, because there's actually a lot of books out on running businesses and so on, and it's like a needle in a haystack. How do you know which one is a good one?
That's a good one.
Good to know. We should probably make a little notes page with things like that on there, actually, so that you don't have to scroll back through the whole video to find that little one piece of information. We'll try and put that out somewhere.
That's all I have. Suzy, is there anything more?
I was going to talk a little bit more about branding. I don't know if anyone's seen it, but in our ebook store, we've got a book that's free with any purchase, and it's on photographing your yarn. But the first half of the book is about branding, and I might actually just revamp that into its own little book, because since I wrote that, I've also expanded on my ideas with that as well. And that might be useful for anybody looking at, you know, creating the online presence as well. Perhaps I'll extract some of that out and just make it available on our website somewhere for download. But I think we've covered so much during the session. I don't want to sort of throw a heap more onto it, because there's, you know, there's a lot to it. I think some of the key things that have come out have been the importance of prioritizing, focusing where you're going to put your attention, and what you need to stop procrastinating about and just do, and spreadsheets, learning how to use spreadsheets. I think that's one of the other
key. Those are great takeaways.
Well. Yeah. Artists will tell, I'll put up a note somewhere with the book, a link to the book. So I forgot the name of it already as well, I see. One ear at the other. So you've got to write things down. I mean, I tell you what I got just recently, and it's something Evanita showed me. It's a whiteboard journal, and it's on the other side of the room, so I can't show you. But it's just a little notebook, and each page is like a whiteboard, and you write on it with a whiteboard pen. And as you finish tasks, you can actually just get rid of them, clean sweep, wipe them off the board. And it's actually a really good little tool. It's much easier to use than a spreadsheet. And I just have so many notes scribbled around on different journals that I was getting lost with. Oh, I wrote that down, I can't find it. So just basic organization and picking up tips from other people like that. I mean, it's such a cool little thing to have. So I have found that easier to use than a spreadsheet, I'm afraid, Arlene.
We're going to have a whole session on to-do lists and journals and time management. That'll be
That time management thing, that is such a big thing, because it's like, do I spend my time creating stuff, or do I spend my time marketing the stuff I have created? And I tell you what, if you want to run an online fiber business, you know, that's predominantly online, it's a big job. It's not something you can go and spend half an hour a day at and then the rest of the time just spin yarn, because you're going to end up with a huge amount of yarn, and half an hour a day is not enough to actually go out and sell it. You've really got to put a lot of time and effort and be really serious and focused about where you want to go with it. So I think another session on time management would be very, very useful, because I think everyone struggles with that, especially when you've got kids and family and all the other responsibilities, and prioritizing things is so important. It's easy to get muddled up and start panicking about deadlines and what you've got to do when. Yeah, Jennifer also says a session on organising tips. I think, I'm glad I'm not alone with that, Jennifer. I think we all struggle with staying organised and feeling like, you know, I mean, this is why I drink so much coffee, probably.
I have some good tricks on that. We'll do a whole session on that. And I'm just as evangelical about that as I am about financial statements.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I think that's it, everybody. Have a great week. And we'll see you soon.
Thanks for joining us.